basically Cleon had been to Marrakesh and Todra before, and I'd known of these sort of painted rock places. We got a postcard from somebody who'd been out there at work of like lots of boulders, and you know, you put the word out and people say, yeah, yeah, there's some climbing at Tafraout. So kind of got the Lonely Planet guide and booked some EasyJet flights to Malaga. Cost like 25 quid return or something. You fly out there, go to the bus station, get a bus down to a place called Al Jazeera's, get on a ferry, that's about $25, that takes you to Morocco, and then you're in Tangiers, which is real fucking shithole. We got in there in time to book a Cougette on like the night train to Marrakesh, so I got on a train to Marrakesh and slept, arrived there at 8 in the morning. We could have actually got straight on a bus and gone to carried on, but we stayed a night in Marrakesh, which was an experience, kind of like a big city, kind of, that's a bit, I would say backwards, but I think I'll be putting them down. You know, it's not London or New York. It's a sign of kind of like a developing world tourist destination. And there's a lot of Western tourists walking around there now, and I'm sure they wouldn't have half the little like shops in the market that they did if there wasn't a lot of tourism there. Went to the night market, ate on the square because Cleon recommended it. Fucking hell, wasn't really too sure about some of the cooking.
Let's have a look at it. Is this a cooked sausage?
It proved to be like a decision that you possibly, well, no, I would have ate there anyway, so you know, you just accept it, don't you, that if you eat in a place like that, okay, or if you eat in some places like that, you're going to get ill.
This is the boot that VZ has been taken for some time now. Due to being the first one of us to be icky dicky.
Had my first solid shit this morning. Well, it was more solid than the others I've been. So I think I'm getting over that. I can't fart with confidence yet, but hopefully I will do.
How are you, Chris?
Well, I don't want to fart, I have
to say. Cleon?
So I woke up in the middle of the night and went for one rather large thing that cleared everything out, and let's be honest, it didn't look good this morning, but hell-hum, it doesn't seem to be as bad as dysentery, so we'll see what it's like by the end of the day, I think.
So how are you this morning, Simon?
Not very good. Things are a bit loose.
Things is loose.
A bit of concern last night. Woke up in the middle of the night and was like, I think I'm going to go now. And I couldn't find any bog roll as well, you hid it all, so.
Took a little bit off the trip, but you know, you're only talking like 5 days, you know, still got out most days, just couldn't climb that much, so sort of semi-rest days. But from Marrakesh we got a bus down to Agadir, and then we got a taxi to Tafraout, which is about a 5 hour taxi drive, and it cost us I think 60 quid with five of us in a big Mercedes. Pretty bonkers. Two people crammed in the front, three people crammed in the back.
What place is this?
Cool.
For, yeah, right.
So, nice comfy ride, lads.
Ah, you want to? I'm still got a fucking gear stick.
I thought you were joking, that kind of thing, anyway.
I don't really consider climbing to be that much of an adrenaline sport, really. Yeah, sure, you do get a kick of adrenaline out of it, but for me, I far more look forward to the times when I'm almost kind of like a peaceful serenity. It becomes slightly therapeutic in the way that you don't really think about climbing a lot some of the time. Your mind will be climbing for you, and you can kind of lose yourself in as your body literally climbs for you, and you hit autopilot, and you know, you can get moments like that all the way through the grades, but usually the harder you're climbing, the harder or the less frequently you get that feeling, because you are having to actually consciously make decisions and deal with the situation in hand. If you push yourself beyond the ability to kind of like hang on for that much longer, then you are going to fall off, and if you can't go down and you can't go up, then you're kind of conceivably in a bad situation that you've got to deal with. I think where you kind of the adrenaline side of climbing can come through short little exhilarating moments where, you know, a handhold might break, your foot might slip.
Whoa!
Yeah. That one of those
I just felt the foot going, it was like, oh.
the hold might completely break on you, and you know, you're heading, you're falling basically. I think all of these things give you kind of a start similar to, I know if you're watching a horror movie and all of a sudden there's one of those kind of moments. Bouldering's about kind of condensing climbing into its kind of purest form. Basically, climbing is actually just moving over rock, and if you're climbing roots, you're encumbered by all sorts of you're encumbered by all bits of kind of climbing paraphernalia. Sort of, you've got a harness on, you're tied into a rope, you've got a load of wires around your waist, friends, a bunch of quick draws, maybe some slings. You know, you're actually, you kind of weighed yourself down with kit, and you've kind of reduced your mobility. Whereas bouldering, you've got the clothes that you're wearing, a pair of rock shoes, and a tiny chalk bag. You know, it's minimalist, and you're basically trying to climb the hardest move that you can. And in doing that, you are actually improving your climbing on any other kind of medium, really. You know, you're learning climbing movement, which is a massive part of being able to climb well. You know, if you come up to a move on a climb and you can't see how to do it, you're going to be stood there for 10 minutes working out how to do it. Whereas if you kind of get there and you think, well, that looks a bit like that boulder problem, you know, you're going to do it, you're going to try it that way because you've tried that boulder problem that way, and on you go. Whereas, you know, and you could do that move fairly quickly and possibly fairly efficiently, because if you've seen a similar move on a boulder problem and you couldn't do it first time, you would have sort of tinkered around with your technique until you did it the easiest way. Yeah, so I think it's all to do with an individual movement, really. You know, it could be a series of movements that you're trying to do, or, you know, one really sick hard move. They're all kind of very relevant to bouldering.
Go directly up, Si.
One of the reasons I like traditional climbing is, you know, it's not, you know, sport climbing is, you know, there's very little risk involved now with modern sport climbing. You know, you just go up, click bolts, and you're away. It's a very easy thing for people to get into, you know, and it just comes down to total strength most of the time. Whereas at trad climbing, it you need the same sort of stamina that you could use on a sport climb, but you're putting in the protection, so you know, you actually need more, really. You know, you're hanging out for quite a while, fiddling in little runners to protect you, and you know, you might kick them out with your feet. There might not be a very good placement. You know, you've got to fully be on the ball all the time. It's very rewarding. You know, sometimes you can actually be stood there arranging gear for quite a while, and it's almost therapeutic going through that hole, stood there on a ledge, fiddling in wires, thinking to yourself, fuck, fuck, I want another. And then that moment when you decide that you're going to leave that little tranquil place of safety, and you're going to go up above it and into a place where, you know, you can hurt yourself. Yeah, it's thoroughly rewarding, really. And the thing is you can either be a strong climber in like well protected climbs, or you can be a bold climber and like things that might not necessarily be as hard, but are a lot bolder than other sort of types of, a lot bolder than other routes of the same ilk.
Or this will fit in.
That might fit in that little spot.
Yeah, exactly. Over. Yeah.
What is that? What do they call this?
It's a homemade haul bag. What's this name over here?
A duffel bag.
All right. I think
can we get it?
We're gonna be able to stand it.
Yeah, and that's put it right. Not this much weight.
Chance we might be off. It's now Friday. We've been here since Sunday. And he reckons we can get in. Base camp for Denali's closed, but we're going to give it a go to the Kichatnas anyway.
If we don't get in, it's a charter flight, so it's $325 an hour. So let's hope we get in.
But he's keen, so we'll give it a go.
He's keen. He's a fucking good pilot, by all accounts. We hear these stories from people with other companies and like pools of man, basically.
Yeah.
He got into base camp yesterday, and I don't think anyone else did. So
pilot went in yesterday with a load of people to base camp Denali. He turned around, came back, pool jumps on the plane, took him straight in, so.
If anyone can get us there, he the man.
He'd be the boy.
Have a plan a trip like to Alaska. Oh, the Alaska trip was a lot harder than the Morocco trip to plan. It was, there aren't that many pictures of where we wanted to go. We were lucky in the fact that some friends of mine from my village had actually been out there the year before and the year before that. So what we did is had a look at some of their photos. They gave us a little bit of information, and then we got like the guide to Alaska, and it's got some stuff in, but not many people go to the Kichatna Spires because it's so out of the way. When we'd chosen the destination, you know, I was pre-set on the Kichatna Spires. We had to find an objective, so we came up with a few ideas from what we saw in the guidebook, and we had to put these ideas sort of like together in a bit. It was a bit of a proposal, and then we send that proposal with an application to the Welsh Sports Council. Having lived in Wales for 8 years and being a resident in Wales, it means that you're entitled to apply for an overseas sort of expedition grant. Basically, the Welsh Sport Council and the English Sports Council accept that in things like climbing, canoeing, and a lot of these adventure sports, there isn't a sort of a World Cup to go to, and that a lot of these sports rely on adventure and the adventure of going to new places. I don't think there isn't that much that kind of can prepare you for Alaska in a wanna, really. It's, for me, it was a culmination of like years of climbing and stuff like that. You know, having started off going to Yosemite big wall climbing and then going elsewhere, free climbing sort of big lumps of rock in the Alps, Morocco, that went to the Circuit of the Inclinables in Canada, which is another area very similar to Alaska, but there's no real glaciers, so you're sort of camping on grass, although you are, and you know, you are being flown into the middle of nowhere to get there. Whereas Alaska was, it's a lot further north. You're going off a glacier, and I've never really lived off a glacier, let alone for sort of like a good couple of weeks at a time. So it was going to be a new and interesting experience for me in that way, but you know. The fact that we were going there to climb rock meant that, and you know, I think I was well prepared for that. It's just kind of like glacier travel and things like that. I was a bit sketchy on, you know, didn't want to shoot down too many holes. Oh fuck. Hang on.
Morning, it's about 10:30. We flew in yesterday, which is a bit hair raising, and we literally kind of brushed the wingtips with these slabs, so we've walked down. We're going to see what we can do with them. It was a pretty hair-raising flight. We nearly flew into a cliff up there. right at the head of the valley, and we actually managed to land on this glacier, so yeah.
Okay, kid, take it out. Okay, so a bit of sun-drenched slab climbing, never hurts. Not setting up pitch two now. So after a day of total whiteout conditions, this is a little bit unexpected. Yep, pitch three. Look at the weather. And look at that big corn up there. Yo yo, what's up? Where's it? Pitch 5?
Yeah, sounds about right.
Looking at it, it looks absolutely amazing. So we've got it just looks like a beautiful sort of 5.8 hand crack. My main worry is it's going to be about 70 metres long, and it's just more than the rope. But, I mean, I was told that climbing here is like climbing on the Chamonix wheels. I mean, this really is. Right, let's get up it.
Moving together with a rope on, kind of thing.
The thing is, I'm thinking descent is best, I think.
Yeah.
I think if we can move together on it, and we can move together on the way back down, then that's good.
Yeah.
If we can't, then I'm not sure we need to get to the notch.
Yeah.
Time's 5:30, and what we decided was it's a bit too far. We're only about halfway up this thing. We didn't leave very early. On our way back down, and unfortunately it means
drilling bolts.
Is there anything else to make granite here? Well, it's 9:05. Basically, we've just climbed this big buttress of rock up here. Take a line up the middle to the top of the buttress, but not to the top of the wall itself, but the top. Time didn't sort of do us any favours on that, so. Tell you what, yesterday, I was knackered. I was absolutely shattered from climbing the day before. And we had done a long day's worth of climbing, and I think we both just slept on an awful day, didn't we?
Pretty much, it was a good day. I think eventually we forced ourselves to go out at like 5:00 in the evening.
That was actually quite nice to get out, although I was wired on coffee when I went. But the encouraging thing was, from the walk, we think we've spied a few interesting climbs. We went up into the flat top cirque, which has got some, it's got half a dozen or so routes in it already, but it looks like there's potential for a lot more to go in there, either new routes or to go and do some repeat of some existing routes. So that's probably where we're going to focus some attention, I think.
Oh fuck. It's been raining for 3 days now. It did rain for the 2 days before that, but I mean, it's been raining solidly for 3 days.
It hasn't quite stopped. We've had to cook in the tent, like probably in the tent, closed door, darting out to get food, darting out to go to the toilet. Don't need to go into details of that, but you can imagine it's not lovely in the rain. Basically, it's Thursday. We climbed last on Saturday. And we've been in the tent ever since.
The bag didn't make it any easier.
No, not at all. Go on. Nice one to see. That I led quite a few of the harder pitches in Alaska, whereas Steve kind of pulled it out of the bag when we needed it the most. I was totally physically drained and quite mentally drained from leading three hard pitches in a row, and then a fourth hard pitch after sort of seconding a pitch, and was just totally exhausted. And you know, Steve with his adventure racing stamina just keeps going as if it's, you know, steady away really, which was it was really good. And a good partnership. Hello there, we're on our way down. It's now about 1 o'clock in the morning. We've been climbing since about 11 o'clock. We've wrapped about 4 or 5 pitches down, and we've still got about another 4 or 5 to do. So what Steve's doing down there, he's ebbing down, and he's putting in a bolt on a ledge where we lost belayed.
I'm absolutely exhausted, to be quite honest with you. Yeah, it's pretty nice though. For the first time, you know, we had 5 days of rain, woke up and it wasn't raining. It stopped raining about 9-10 o'clock.
So, 10 to 3. Not bad time really, considering the fact that we've done a hell of a lot of climbing and actually a lot more difficult than we probably thought it would be. There's some pitches that, you know, we thought would be, you know, just gifts, and they weren't. And yeah, and it was all quite steep, apart from the first two pitches, which were just boring slabs. But yeah, an impressive route on the Kichatna Spire. I have to think of a name and a number.
Okay then. Okay then, cheers.
Okay.
Bye.
Alrighty, bye bye. 6 o'clock in the morning. You've got to wait for the runway to fucking harden up. It's fucking void.
The runway's hardening up?
Yeah. Let's hope it's good weather in the morning.